Hi, good evening. My name is Arvind, and I'm going to talk about how big data analysis and social semantic web can bring you about a good web experience. So every single blog post, every single Twitter update, every single status update that you make on Facebook actually adds to the big data that is already there available on the web. And what also happens is that there is a parallel talk going on about your about whatever status update or whatever tweet that you made, but it's very hard to interlink those communications because it's not happening in say a particular markup language. So say that there is, take up for example that there is a Twitter update that you made and there is a Facebook, one of your friends is talking about your Twitter update on his Facebook timeline, but you can't connect them essentially. So let us take again for another example that say you want to send across a link to your friend, but what you see is that on the link there is a wrong phone number. So what the option that you would have right now is maybe to contact the administrator of the web page and tell him that could you please change this number to this number. But then more often than not, those kind of conversations don't happen with like immediate replies. You can't see that the number has been changed like immediately. Maybe it would take a day. So what you would do is maybe send the number with the correct number, send the correct number on your Twitter, and with the link you would send it across to him. So then when your friend actually sees that page, he would have to cross-reference the number on your Twitter update and check it out, and then he would have to dial that number. But think of this web experience when he can actually see that number on the page rather than having to cross-reference that particular correct number on the page. So he could just, when he's on the page, he could just see that the number is there, the correct number is there. So this kind of web experience is a very different one. So say for doing these kind of annotations, maybe a browser bookmarklet or maybe a browser extension could help you doing these kind of annotations. So say there is a user profile maybe built into the browser which would say like, these are my friends and only the annotations from these people I would accept. So you can see that there is a social networking aspect that comes into this. So you would say because he's my friend, I would turn on the annotations from him, but because X is not my friend, I would block the annotations from him. So let us say maybe there's an element in page bar which has got the X part. So all these annotations or whatever happens are basically linked with element to element. So say there's a particular element which you know the X part for, and there is another element in say another page, say maybe a fire safety page, and you have a blog about it. So you would cross link both of them, saying like these two elements are related to each other in a particular way. And when your friend has turned on all these annotations from you, he can see that all those comments or those annotations turn up because he has subscribed to you. Let us take up this page for an example. This blog is done by Jace. He talks about outsource versus open source in this particular blog. At the end of the blog, you can see that he says that he has blocked the comments because he can't handle spam over here. So you can see that but what he also does is he gives you a link so where you can go and follow the comments or the talks that are going on about this particular blog. But what you can think is that this is only one place that the talks are happening, but there could also be, all these talks could also be going on maybe say Twitter, Facebook, blogs, or anywhere else on any other some media which has not been linked over here. So let us go to this page and see. So you can see that there's a whole big commenting going on over here. So now what you would need to do is, if you want to read the comment, you need to come here, and then again you need to go back to read the blog. I mean, frankly speaking, I go to the most of the blogs just to read the comment. So that actually gives you a very different experience when you read what somebody else is saying or what somebody else's experience is of that particular blog. We can actually see that there is a debate going on whether GPLv3 is good or BSD is good. So those kind of comments are like totally good for flame wars. Somebody has done a feed. Say somebody tweets about saying that there are comments. So say there are comments for this particular element here in Jace's page, and then he says that there are comments for that for the JSS page over here, and you could say just maybe Twitter it. And when somebody comes to this page, say JSS page using, so somebody could do say maybe do a feed like this. He says there's a JSS page, and there is the expert for that particular element. So you could say like this particular unique element is related to that element in that page. With say maybe with the tags with GPL v3 and stuff like that. So say there's a bookmarklet, the user has it, and he can see the annotations up over here. So say a user has this bookmarklet enabled, and whenever he comes to this page, he can actually see just this. So so there is a recommendation engine which would say maybe like push up. They're saying because you are this person's friend, you can look up these annotations done by your friend. So so maybe say I'm interested in this. So what you can actually see is now all the comments from that page are loading up over here. So this kind of semantic linking it would give you a very very different experience of the web altogether. And then also like maybe say imagine threading in with the use of timestamps. So we can see that if people could say mark for this particular comment, there is a comment somewhere else on Twitter, and it could be threaded according to some to a particular use case. Then
can I ask a question?
Sure.
I see that two connected documents got interlinked, and you can view them in one place.
Right.
But what is semantic about all of this?
So the semantic thing is say these are related by somebody. So you are defining your own semantics. So see, when you say semantic web, there's a particular maybe an ontology which defines the semantics of the semantic web, right? So you define your ontology. So say imagine it for a very small custom web of yours. You say like I'm interested in these pages, and these are related to these. So you define your own ontology on here, and that is how it's a semantic web in itself. I mean, it's semantic in a sense everything is interconnected.
But that's the web, right?
It's the web. But then what you can see is you don't see the interconnectedness on a page, given page. So say I just go to JSS page, and I can't see the comments over there. I need to either have say maybe a bookmarklet like this, or maybe I need to keep jumping through the loops. So I need to go say even here for this matter. Say you have a link over here. So you have a link on this particular page. I mean, this is not coming showing up over here. So you can see that. Think of annotations. I mean, think of this in a multiple level. So say maybe when you can come up here, because you're interested in this, there could be other recommendations by your friend. With say maybe like your third friend did this. He says like this comment is related to something else. So, and that could come up over here. So that kind of experience of the web is a very different one. Right. It's not about semantic tools. It's about semantic web. How you can define your own web. How you can have a custom web of your own.
So basically, you take the normal web, which is a document web,
right? Yeah.
Out of which you create a semantic layer,
right,
that lets you navigate across these different things, which is the actual semantic is defined by.
But shouldn't the semantic layer be about meaning?
You define the meaning.
Semantics are all about.
Right.
Where's the meaning piece in this? I don't understand. I mean, I understand connected documents, but that's what the web was always.
It was always.
Just bringing it on, you're bringing it on one page, I understand that. But then where's the meaning exchange? That's what semantic web is about, right? It's about communicating more meaning than just plain text. And where
right,
are
right.
That?
So I mean, this is just text. Maybe what? So think of something else over here. I mean, not just text, but maybe it could be any documentary or whatever. I mean, don't think of it just as plain text. It's just an example over here that I'm taking. So say, maybe think of, in the future slide, in the next slides, I'll show you how this could make sense. So let us go forward.
This looks more like social bookmarking.
Right, I mean, so see, bookmarking in a sense, so you can't do this in as of now. I mean, how would you do this? You would need to...
There are many tools like or others.
Right, so then what happens is there is content with them. So say even take up for example take up Discuss. So you can do a commenting engine in Discuss. You could just embed in your site. But then again, what happens is your content is with them. It's not with you. It's more about the content is distributed. Say Think, for example. I mean, where I took up this one. This could be coming from your own blog. It need not be somewhere else. So you could say that. I mean, like I blogged about this. So I mean, look this up over here. So when you do maybe a feed over here. So when you want to do the feed, you would say like, I mean, I'm the author and I say like these two elements are related here. Say you take up your blog and say Jace's page has got comments in my particular blog. So that would come up. The idea of like doing this this kind of feed passing, I mean, so basically what these kind of feeds could actually be passed by a service. Say maybe somebody runs a service and picks them up and does it for everybody. So maybe say a browser could read these feeds and serve it to the people. So whenever they come up, so you say let us say that there's a browser profile of yourself, and then the browser could recommend you all these annotations or re-narrations or comments, basically looking up your profile. So what we did is we implemented this particular idea of feed passing into one of the platforms that we have been developing. It's a re-narration web framework. It's called LAP.us. So what LAP is about enabling re-narrations on the web. So you could basically re-narrate, say, maybe a paragraph of text to another language or the same language, or maybe annotate it with, say, audio content of in your own voice. It's not like machine reading or anything. It's your own voice which you're doing it, or maybe say putting up an image in place of the text. So let us take, for example, this particular page. So this page is about the minimum wages by the Government of India, which we took up to do narrations so that it could reach a lot of people, because most of the government laws, and I mean almost all the content on the web is in English. We wanted it to reach people who can't read English, who can maybe who can't even read their own mother tongue. So we took the help of a few of the NGOs and also a law forum, and then re-narrated it in all these languages. So let us check the Hindi one maybe. So maybe say again think of this as a browser profile. So your browser would know that you know only Hindi, and it could suggest you all these things. So this kind of an experience when you come to this page, it's somebody else has done this for you. Maybe a friend of yours has done this for you, and when you come to this page, you can see that all these annotations come up right there for you to consume. Right, so in translator.google.com, it's a machine translation. Here, somebody has typed it. So somebody, it's a human-based effort, something like Wikipedia. So what you do is, you take up a document, because you want to send it to your friend, you add the context to it. Generally, what happens in all the translators is you lose the grammar and the context too.
So you need a translator to translate all the documents?
No, not really. So, it is not about a document. I mean, right now it's only about the web pages on the web. It's not about.
I want to send a page to a friend which is in English language, and it has to be translated to Hindi. So I need a translator for that.
No, you could see the emphasis over here is about how you could make your friend understand what the content. It is not about translating. It is not about being in the language that you essentially want it to be, but. Think of it, say maybe you could annotate this image and put up a different image over here. So think of this page, if you say like you want to change the image over here to something else, you want it to be a table, and you take up a picture of a table and put it up over here and you send it to him. Or maybe you could remove all the text in the page and just put images, or just put one audio link, one audio recording of yours, and it could be the summary of the page. That can't be done by the translators.
So he also needs.
No, right now there's no plugin. What I'm saying is there could be, I mean, in the future, there could be an extension or the browser would have these capabilities.
So this pre-narrated page will be stored in your web server?
It would only be cached. So all this, so I'll just show you this. So all this content is coming from somebody else's blog. So as I show you over here, so see, there are re-narrations. Somebody has done a re-narration and the content is sitting somewhere else. It's a distributed model. It's not coming from the server. It's only cached at the server. So you can see that there are, this is the X path, and then there is another, this is the X path at the blog. And you can also see that there is, so here is the content that is coming from.
Yeah, how would you stop spam?
Spam is not handled by, another way, you could add filters, and you say like, because he's my friend, I would only read his annotations or his particular content, and the others I would block.
How is his different?
So here there are blocks. So you would know, like, so you could say maybe you could like redefine the whole filter as an XML based one, and you would say like, these are my friends. And so as I told, like, think of it as a browser extension where the browser knows your profile, and you would say like, these are my friends. So it would have an FOAF, and it would say, okay, because these are your friends, I would only push you these. We wanted to extend this particular idea to do a digital heritage walk. So a digital heritage is basically when you experience the heritage on a web, say you can walk around a particular area which has got heritage, and you can experience all of it on your web browser. So we took up this mural from Lepakshi, which is this one in question is particularly a 16th century mural. And think of it, say maybe like one of your friends who could tweet about this and say, say this particular face over here, it looks very similar to, to the one found in Egyptian murals. So yeah, coming back to what you asked, this would make a lot of sense. So say your friend says like, this particular face has got a very much resemblance to an Egyptian mural. So when you're walking, say you're walking through the mural, and there's a mural on your left side, and when you're looking at it, so this could pop up. I mean, all the annotations done for this particular mural come up, and something like this. So all the annotations would come up because you are looking at and you have turned on your friend's annotation. Any questions?
All the annotations and everything will be indexed in your website, or?
Right, yeah, it's only indexed. But see, I mean, this is indexed because right now we are the only one who are running the service. So you could also build up your own indexer, and you could also put it up like where you don't want it anyone else to see it. Right, it is. So, and if you go here, you can find the source code. No. So, I mean, we don't transform the user does it. So, so maybe like, let us take, so let us maybe say, so say a user comes up to this page and he has this bar, say maybe. So you could just go, click on this one, say re-narrate. And say I want to change this image, so I would get like, say, replace image. You could just paste an URL over here, or maybe say like anything, and that would be how it would transform. Or also say you want to add audio to a particular piece of text, so you could add audio and then just save your changes, and it would be published to your blog. So you don't have to, store it with somebody else. It would be on your particular blog, and if you want to change the content, just ask for a re-index. It would be done.
I view the page through your blog.
Yeah.
That is when I will see the changes.
right now it's from this URL. So if you use this, but yeah, I mean, if you, let us say you have a browser extension which could do that, yeah, you could see it on the place.
So you said you could change that image over there, right?
Yeah.
And you could do stuff with the HTML content also.
Right.
Now, where is this edited HTML being stored? I mean,
so yeah, as I showed you, there is. So what happens is the crawler, there would be a crawler which would run on and pick up attributes. So it is, everything is on your blog. It is not stored anywhere.
Okay.
So see, I mean, as I told you, see, here is a element type of audio. So here is the blog link. So if you go to this blog link, you can see a blog post which is done with this particular audio content. And whenever, I mean, a page is requested, it's only indexed. So we can see that the content is here. It's not being stored in a central server somewhere. Yeah, so the content is coming from here.
Is it interconnected with social graphs or anything?
No, not really. We have not done that. Thank you.